on. All right. You guys look good today. Thanks for being here. I was just standing there thinking, wow, it was just 2 weeks ago. 2 weeks ago today, I was somewhere around 10,000 miles away from here, and I was in a little village, and I preached a 12-minute sermon. I know that. No, really, really. Because it's translated into two languages. All right, French and then Lobi. So a 12-minute sermon took 36 minutes. All right. And what was incredible about that day is, though it's a village, I've only been in one other time in my life. At the end of that service, a man who had been attending that village church, they told me for about 6 weeks. At the end of the service, when I gave an invitation, I said, if there's anybody here who wants Jesus Christ to be their Savior, Lord, and life, would you have the courage to stand? And this 6'4" Ivorian stood straight up. By the time the prayer was over, that the pastor in the village church let him in, there were tears streaming down his face. We had 10 to baptize afterwards in a bathtub. Because they won't, Mike won't let me get in the river there, all right? That's where most of the disease come from, all right? And the things that create infection. So they brought an old bathtub in last year for the baptism that we did, and the bathtub hasn't moved in a year. It's in the same place it was a year ago, and the village pastor said a man came by during the last year and offered him $60 for the bathtub. Because bathtubs are on short supply out that part of Africa. He said, no, no, that's our baptismal. And so we had 10 scheduled for me to baptize that day, but I ended up baptizing 12. And I asked the pastor, where'd the other two come from? He said, I don't know, they snuck in. And so we're always happy to let them sneak in for baptism. That was really cool. But wow, that was just 2 weeks ago. I've been so grateful this week. Everybody's been asking, Tim, how's the recovery going this year? I got to be honest. By Wednesday, life was normal. So really, in about 3 days, nights were not confused anymore. I slept great. Shelly had been cooking up a storm, man, just feeding me. So it's been wonderful around the house. But God was so, so gracious this year. So we're excited about that. Let me welcome today, if you are a guest, it's your first time here, you have honored us with your presence. There are some communication cards in the pew in front of you or behind you. I'd love for you to grab one, fill it out when we have our offering in a bit. You can drop that in the offering bag, and next week through the mail we'll send you information about the church, just so you know what goes on around here. We promise not to annoy you on a telephone or beat on your door, but through the mail give you some helpful information. We'd love to have you back. Let me highlight several announcements. There is a sign up sheet to go around. I only have one, and there should be two. So somebody's going to go find the other one. There are two things on the sign up sheet. Let me highlight those real quick. Number one, parking posse. If you would be willing to volunteer to assist, it's usually during the 9:15 to 10:45 service, and that gap in between there when it's very congested, going in and out between those two services. They're looking for folks so that you only have to be used about once every 4 to 6 weeks. And signing this does not make a commitment to you. It just says, I'd like information. I'd be willing to consider helping in this area. So if you'd be willing to do that, a place for your name and your email address, and they'll follow up with you. The sheet on the bottom, this has to do with our Mexico mission trip with our high schoolers. Every year during Easter week, our kids go to Mexico on a mission trip. And they're doing their best this year. Sometimes what's happened in the past is some people in the church didn't get a letter at all from one of our students saying, hey, would you be willing to help us go to Mexico, whether it's $5, $10, $50. And then some families got 7 or 8 letters. Okay, and so we're trying to prevent that from happening. And so if you would be interested in receiving a letter, all right, from one of our kids going to Mexico and prayerfully consider being of help, just put your name and contact information in there, and they will do that. So those are the sign-up sheets. One is there, and the other one's going down this side. Thank you so much. This afternoon after the third service at about 12:15 to 12:30, Widow's Lunch Bunch is meeting at Toledo's for lunch today. I'm assuming that's the Toledo's in Clovis, Sierra Vista Mall, all right? And so they would love to have you join them for that lunch today at about 12:15 to 12:30. Fresno Clovis Prayer Breakfast is this Tuesday. It's downtown at the Exhibit Hall. we've had 3 tables. I have one ticket left out of 30, all right? If you are interested in going, you need to see me right after the service, okay? First one who sees me gets it, $15. Chuck Swindoll is the speaker. You may never get another chance to hear him in person again, all right? He's 83 years old. That makes me feel really bad because as a kid growing up, as an adult working at the Christian bookstore, he became my favorite author. We had him in Fresno 3 times in my days at the Bible House, and he was just a young man then. So anyway, I'm excited about Chuck being here. For those of you who already have a ticket and are going, we are going to carpool for those who would like. We will meet here in the church parking lot at 6 a.m. All right? Breakfast starts at 7, but it's a packed house. It's sold out, all right? We may have the one last ticket left, all right? And so if you want to carpool, because it's $10 to park downtown, we wheels up here at 6:05, okay? And we're heading downtown. Women's Spring Luncheon, you may see Fawn, all right? If you would like a ticket for that, it's this coming Saturday, so you can catch her after the services or this week in the office. Be happy to get you a ticket for that. Choir practice for Easter starts this Wednesday night at 6:30. Three things. One, we took it really easy on our choir members at Christmas, all right? We made that a different kind of Christmas musical, so it was really, didn't require much commitment, all right? We're shortening the rehearsal time for Easter, all right? So it's only 5 weeks of rehearsal, so this is pretty easy, all right? I would love 40 voices in the Easter choir. It is the number one day of the year is Easter Sunday. There is not a greater event in the history of the world. Did I say Christmas? Oh, all right. Sometimes I say Christmas when I mean Easter, but I mean Easter this time, all right? So would love to have you in the Easter choir. If you could carry a tune, you don't have to read music, though it's helpful, but if you carry a tune and if you look good, all right, which is all of you, because all of y'all look better than I look, all right? So they would love to have you in the choir, and it's going to start this week. And I threw a little gauntlet down. If there's 40 voices in the choir, Shelly and I are going to host a barbecue at our house for the choir, all right? So, all right, and I think Bite Me Barbecue will be doing the cooking for us, all right? Couple of guys from our church, all right? So they do a great job. All right, save the date. Last week we had some inserts in the bulletin, March the 3rd. Celebrate Recovery has been ministering to folks for 7 years through New Hope Church. So we would like, yeah, amen. We would like to celebrate with Celebrate Recovery. Some people in the past have thought, oh, I can only come if I've been to Celebrate Recovery. No, this is a church-wide celebration. So that night, they're not going to put you into a support group, okay? That night, it's dinner on the grounds, hot dogs and hamburgers, and then we'll come in the sanctuary, and there will be worship music and testimonies, and this is a night of celebration. And so for those of you who've never had a hurt or a habit or a hang-up in your life, come and celebrate with the rest of us who have, all right? And literally hundreds of people have been ministered to over the last 7 years through our Celebrate Recovery. If you think you are going to show up that night because they want to have enough food, if you think you are going to make it, you've getting it on your calendar, March the 3rd, a Thursday night, raise your hands, please, raise your hands. You think you're going to make it that night. All right, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, 20, 21, 22, 23, 24, 25, 26, 27, 28, okay, third, got some back there, all right, 31, all right, great, thank you, we'll pass that on, write 31 down for me, babe, all right, I'll sleep before tomorrow and I'll forget it. Okay, let's see here, the pie auction. That's one of the primary ways in which we support the project for our kids going to Mexico. We have an old-fashioned pie auction. I play auctioneer for an hour and a half to 2 hours, and we want to auction off your best pies, your best homemade desserts, your best meal, all right? We have casseroles and dinner for 6 or 8 or 10, but we'll auction anything off, all right, as long as it's legal and not immoral. Okay, and so bring the things that night and bring your checkbooks. All right, last year we raised $17,000 at the pie auction. So come and join us for that evening. We'd love to have you there. Please take the opportunity to read the rest of the bulletin. The only other event I want to talk about is this afternoon at 5 o'clock. If you are in this service and you find yourself between 25 and 40, or you are married to somebody who falls within that age group, all right? You get grandfathered in if you happen to be slightly older than your spouse. We would love to have you here at 5 o'clock. This is going to be a 45-minute to an hour meeting at most. This is a critical time, I believe. For me, it's one of the most important times in my 24 years of ministry here at New Hope. We've been talking about it for over a month now. We've put invitations in your hand. We're going to have nothing but cakes here for refreshments afterwards. So if you find yourself in that age group, Mark and I really, really want you here. We want to talk with you. We want you to talk to us. It's going to be easy. It's going to be non-confrontational. But you are the future when I am dead and gone. And we need to know some things from you. So would love to have you here at 5 o'clock today. Let me highlight a couple of prayer requests. Joe Newby, been a regular around New Hope for 30-some-odd years. She was part of the original church, all right? She's in the 8 o'clock service most Sundays. She is leaving the state. She is moving east, and she is going to be leaving on March the 19th. So those of you who know Joe, you may want to reach out to her before that date because she will be gone. Paulie Good from our 8 o'clock service continues to battle her cancer. She had a PET scan on Friday, and she's hoping to be encouraged by the results on Wednesday. Judy Woodley's sister is in St. Agnes Hospital at this moment. She has had a lot of pain. Things are not looking good. They're talking maybe this could be hours. So would appreciate you to pray for Judy Woodley's sister as well as Judy as she's there caring for her. Got a text today. My grandson. Doesn't that sound so cool? He's not 2 months old yet. All right. So I'm just getting the hang of saying my grandson. Bo's got a cold. His first cold. So just thought I would share that. All right, don't usually share such incidentals, but anyway. All right, those are the updates on our prayer requests. Today's also a special Sunday. One of there's two or three things that you just can never get enough of, and one of those things is a baby dedication, and we have one during this service. And so I am going to ask Ian and Brooke if you would please bring your beautiful daughter, Bree Micah Stevens, up front. If you would do that, please. Front and center. Do we have grandparents here? Then grandparents, you may come stand on each side of your son and your daughter. They would love to have you up here. All right? Sure. All right. Rest of the family wave, all right? Rest of the family wave. They're up here right in the front. They're here for this very special moment. Okay, guys, marriage has been good to you, and you all have been good to marriage, and you have this beautiful, beautiful young lady. Give us all the vital statistics about Bree, all right? When she was born, what'd she weigh? How long was she?
She was 9 pounds, 5 ounces.
Nah, just a little one.
Yeah.
Ooh. 21 inches. All right. Very good. All right. And tell us who do you have up here?
This is her sister, Bryn.
All right. Hi, Bryn.
This is Grandma, Grandpa, and Grandma.
All right. Well, welcome, guys. You've been here before, I know, when we've done baby dedications. And so you're kind of familiar with what this is all about. Bree is probably not going to remember anything about today. And so that's why we have this classic little certificate, all right, that you could put in her baby book. And when she's older, tell her about today. It's why I'm sure some of your relatives are taking pictures. Okay. Yes, get those phones out. Yes, get those. It's permissible. Shelly will take a few and send them to you as well. All right, so we'll get a few pictures that you can show to her. There will be a blanket given to you in just a moment. All right, that's a tribute to her to this day. But really, today is Ian. This is more about you, and to Brooke, this is really more about you. And grandparents, it's even a little bit about you all as well. You see, I have no doubt that you all are going to feed and clothe and provide a wonderful house for your daughter to live in. You start feeding her well before she was ever born, okay? So I have no doubt about her physical well-being. The challenge and why we do a baby dedication is to realize that your baby girl is a gift from God. It is a treasure in your treasure chest, and you need to value that. And God would love for you to value this treasure in the same way that He does. And so God gives some direction to mom and dads in Scripture. He tells parents, train up a child in the way in which they should go, so that when they're older, the Word of God will not depart from them. Bringing your little girl to church every Sunday will not guarantee that she is a Christian when she's an adult. Okay, no more than if you lived in a garage, you would be a car. But what it does do in bringing your children to church and teaching them biblical truths at home is it gives them the information that when they reach an age of decision, they have the information to make a choice about. And it's not only the choice about the quality of life they live here and now, but it's the privilege of knowing that someday in eternity, there's this incredible reunion that takes place that lasts far beyond this one. So, mom and dad, if you are prepared to accept that responsibility to raise your daughter in the love and the truth of God, would you say, we will?
We will.
And to the grandparents who were standing there, are you willing to encourage and support your son and your daughter in the raising of your granddaughter in the love and the direction of Christ? If you support them in that, would you say, we do? Perfect. All right. And to the rest of the family who's joined him today, you are part of their cheerleaders. Will you accept the privilege of cheerleading them on? And if they begin to grow a little slack about their engagement in a Christ-centered life, will you encourage them and pray for them? Would you say, if you can, I will? Perfect. Wonderful. Let's see how well we do this. All right. Some days it works really well. Hello, Bree. You are so beautiful. The smile all of a sudden left her face. All right. Hi. Yeah. What do you think? Mom and Dad are still here. And you are so beautiful. And I'm going to ask you all to join hands, all right, as we pray for Bree. And if, okay. We'll give you back. I promise. Nobody's going anywhere. Let's pray. Our Father, I love you. I thank you for this beautiful girl here. And I thank you that she has a voice of her own and she can express her likes and her dislikes. And I pray the day will come that she will express her love for you. We know that you have a plan and a purpose for her, and I trust that her mom and dad will be engaged in helping her discover what your plans and your purposes for her are. Thank you for this day, and may it be a significant moment in this family's life. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Bree, you did so good. You did so good. All right. Look over there for a look right there for a picture. Look right there for a picture. Okay. Look right there for a picture. Well, we're still doing good. Right there. Oh. There. Oh, look right there. Look right there. Oh, look at that picture. Oh, look. Oh, you're doing so good. Yeah. Oh, look right there. One more. Oh, that is good. Okay, you did perfect.
You did perfect. Now cry. Okay, now cry. And we have for you, this is a quilt. This is made by women in our church. All right?
Made for you with love by New Hope Community Church. All right, and so that is our gift to help you remember that day, and there is your certificate. Thank you so much. God bless you. Ladies and gentlemen, are you all warm enough in here? Good. We'll go turn those heaters off here in just a moment. And maybe even turn the coolers on. All right. Let's pray. Father, thank you for life and the life you share with us. We trust you with the needs that have been shared today and the needs, Father, which maybe none of us else in this room know about, but they're personal to someone in particular. And even though we may not know about it, we know that you do. And I trust this will be a day in which those needs can be cast upon you because we believe that you care for us. Thank you for the privilege of giving and sharing, and we do so in the awesome name of Jesus Christ. Amen and amen. If you arrived here today and the words, "it is well with my soul," seem foreign, I hope that by the time you leave here today, that those words will sound very, very familiar. I invite you, if you would please, to find Psalm 23. It's where we're going to kind of be launching from today for the next couple of weeks. There are some psalms that are so big, even though they're short on verses, they are so big that one Sunday is just not going to be adequate. And that is true with the 23rd Psalm. If you are new at New Hope and it's your first time, we started a series at the beginning of the year. It's called The Less, More Lifestyle. What is there in my life that I need less of to make room for some things that I need more of? We often do that at the beginning of a year, and we talk about less weight, more health. We talk about less debt, more finance. But this year, here at New Hope, we want to look at that from not a physical or financial perspective, but we want to look at that from a spiritual direction. We want to find out, God, what is there, what part of me needs to be less so that there's more of you? Less of me, more of Christ. And we discovered that there are four ways for that less, more lifestyle to be maintained. And it starts with a choice. You have to choose to want something different or you're going to get the same old thing. That choice must be followed up with consistency. This must be a daily choice that we make. And what keeps us consistent on making that choice on a daily basis is accountability. And so we've asked, I know this is a little dicey, But we've asked husbands, hey, ask your wife to keep you accountable. We're asking, wives, ask your husbands to keep you accountable. Best friends, co-workers that you work with, people who see you in the trenches of life, tell them, hey, this is a direction I'm wanting my life to go. I want you to help me be accountable to this. And then the last one, and it's why we've chosen the Psalm as our course of study this year, is a fourth word that is foreign to 21st century culture. A word called contemplation. Contemplation. It's a slow, steady thinking of the Scriptures. And the Psalms are written with that ability for us to mull them over, to contemplate them, to think about them, to pray them. And so throughout this year, we're looking at various ways out of the Psalms. This is God's biblical hymn book. And all of these Psalms were intended to be sung. And as I shared in the very first Sunday, there's a song that comes to me quite frequently when I'm feeling a bit discouraged. And it's the words of an old hymn that goes, "In my heart there rings a melody." And I think God directed the writers of the songs to put a melody to these words so that they would ring familiar in the minds and the hearts of the Israelites in the Old Testament as they contemplated their walk with God. I want to read a story to you. It comes out of the introduction to a brand new book called The Lord is My Shepherd. This is one of those books that's written by a friend of mine, actually. His name is Robert Morgan. I met Robert in 1970. I remember it well. In Anaheim, California, he was a brand new pastor of a church out of Nashville, Tennessee, and he was out here for a conference. And though Rob and I don't see each other very often and we don't communicate a lot, whenever we see each other, we kind of pick up with where we left off. And Robert has become an excellent writer. He's probably written about a dozen books, I guess, by now. And his latest one, just the timing was perfect. His latest one is on the 23rd Psalm, and it's called "The Lord is My Shepherd." And in the introduction to that book, he tells the following story. Let me share it with you. Maurice Pink is 90. He lives quietly with his wife in a little house in England about 2 hours northwest of London. He's a British World War II vet who, during the conflict, was ditched in the open sea on 2 different occasions when Japanese forces sunk the ships on which he served. Talking with Rob Morgan on a Sunday afternoon, Maurice described what he called his first dunking. He was 19 years old. He was aboard the battle cruiser, the HMS Repulse, when 5 torpedoes struck that ship on December the 10th, 1941. This was the British Pearl Harbor, It was just 3 days after the attack on the American naval forces in Hawaii. And the Japanese launched a series of raids on British ships in Malaya. More than 800 British sailors perished in the attack that day. Maurice's ship, the Repulse, sank in 7 minutes. Maurice, who played the cornet with the Royal Marine Band, was in the transmitting station on the Repulse. That was 3 decks down, and he was talking on the phone. The explosion from the 5 torpedoes threw him across the room and into the bulkhead. The lights went off. He was trapped. Debris from the explosion blocked the exit and the stairways. There appeared for Maurice no way of escape. The ship was sinking rapidly. And as Maurice struggled to find a way out, he heard the captain's voice come over the ship's speakers. "All hands on deck! Prepare to abandon ship! And God be with you all!" Maurice felt water filling the room and rising up his legs. At once, another sailor, a young midshipman, turned on a flashlight and shouted to Maurice to follow him. He knew of a private ladder that led up to the captain's day cabin, and they clambered up ladders and through passages, finding to their relief the hatches were unlocked. Arriving at the edge of the deck, Maurice stripped off all of his clothes and he jumped into the lukewarm waters of the South China Sea. He had no life vest. The area that he was in was infested with sharks, and Maurice told Robert Morgan that he was naked as a jaybird, not a stitch on. He was a bit disoriented, and he was certainly unsure of which way he ought to swim. For if he got too close to the sinking ship, he would be sucked down by the vortex as the ship sunk. If he got beyond the oil-slicked waters, the sharks would get him. And Maurice began to panic. At that moment of panic, the long memorized words of Psalm 23 came to his mind. He said, out of nowhere, the words just popped in my head. As he treaded water, trying to hold on and trying to hold out, he began quoting those memorized verses to himself over and over and over again. And the words of Psalm 23 buoyed him up. They were better for him than a life vest was. They kept him unsinkable until the British destroyer, the HMS Electra, rescued him an hour later. Maurice asked Robert Morgan that Sunday afternoon, "Robert, would you like me to read to you what I wrote just days after my experience?" Rob quickly replied in the affirmative, and this is what Maurice read from pencil notes on a treasured piece of paper. "There are times in your life when things don't go right and you feel all alone." You ever had one of those moments? Maybe you're in one of those moments. He goes on to say, "That happened to me on December the 10th, 1941, when I was on the battle cruiser Repulse with the nearby Prince of Wales. We were attacked by the Japanese Air Force, resulted in both of our ships sinking. I found myself alone in the water, not able to see or hear anybody else. It was then the 23rd Psalm came into my head, and I realized I was not alone. I had a shepherd. The Lord is my shepherd, and I didn't need to want. I was not in green pastures. I was in oily waters. But he restored my soul. Even though I was walking in the shadow of death, I was to fear no evil, for my shepherd was with me." The rod and staff thing didn't ring a bell with me at that moment until voices above me were shouting. I looked up. There was a big destroyer alongside of me, the Electra, with nets over the side, which allowed me to climb to safety. Nets were my rod and staff that day. I didn't have a table set before me, but I did get a cup of the ship's kai. Mark, are you in here? What's Kai, Mark? No, this is spelled, is it K-Y-E? The book said Coco. I was just checking. I miss that. He's too young for that. World War II. Good. Maurice goes on to write, since that day, goodness and mercy have followed me all the days of my life. And when I think back to that day, don't miss this. When I think back to that day, I wonder what would have happened if I had died instead of lived. There again, Psalm 23 had the answer. I would be dwelling in the house of the Lord forever. Thank you, Lord, for being my shepherd. And thank you, Lord, for the 23rd Psalm. I'm a firm believer that the 23rd Psalm can keep our head above water when our ship seems to be sinking. I know personally, that night that I preached about my first Sunday back after the stents, and I talked about the two dark nights of the soul, that very first one, which I really thought for a while, I'm not going to see the sunrise again. And what settled my anxious moments was somewhere, somehow, the 23rd Psalm came to my mind. I didn't have my Bible in the room with me, and I thought, oh, where's my Bible when I need it? And it was like the Holy Spirit said, hey, your mom and dad taught you this when you were 5 years old. And I know how it was brought to my attention. It's called the Holy Spirit bearing witness with our spirit about the things of God. And that is why it is important for us to memorize Scripture, to visualize Scripture, to study Scripture, to pray it, to sing it, to understand that this passage is in the biggest book of the Bible, and this book is in the very heart of the Scriptures. And it's interesting to note that this chapter is strategically placed between Psalm 22, Psalm 24. That's kind of a habit. 3 usually is found between 2 and 4. But it wasn't by accident. Just pause for a brief challenge. Some of you say, I'm too old to memorize. No, you're not. With the influence of the Holy Spirit in your life, you are not too old to memorize. There's only 6 verses, and they're not very long in Psalm 23. I would strongly encourage you, work on 1 verse a day, and in 1 week, you would have it memorized. But God could not have brought to Maurice's attention the 23rd Psalm. God could not have brought to my attention the 23rd Psalm when we thought our ships were sinking, if for the fact that it wasn't already here. The Lord does not assemble His Word, the Scriptures, haphazardly. They were written over a period of 1,500 years, 40 different authors from 3 continents and in 3 languages. The Bible is the most brilliantly compiled book that's ever been put together. Every part fits the next like an interlocking puzzle. And the more that I study the Scriptures, and it's something I've been doing for 45 years, the more I am awed by the balance and the beauty and blueprint that connects every chapter and every book with the whole. Could we lower the temperature, people are fanning again, all right? So drop it down to about, not that one, the other one. Yeah, yeah, that one right there, perfect. Drop it down to about 68. We might get it to 70, thank you. And I'll just do this. What I've said about the Bible is particularly true about the book of Psalms. The book of Psalms has 150 songs in it, but as we study every one of them, it's helpful for us to notice the one that precedes it and the one that follows it. Sometimes we discover some incredible things. There's often some very enlightening links between those. For example, Psalm 23 is not merely floating around in Scripture like a soft, puffy cloud. It's secure location between 22 and 24 is not an accident. It's actually part of the trilogy known as the Messianic Psalm Trilogy. These are psalms written at the time they were written. They were writing about the yet-to-be-born Savior who was going to come into the world. The first step in understanding Psalm 23 is knowing its setting and understanding its location within the trio of Psalm 22, 23, and 24. These three chapters present the whole story of the gospel of God's grace, and he answers in these three chapters our three greatest questions in life. Psalm 22 answers the question, what about my past? Most of us in this room, we have some regrets about our past, don't we? Most of us in this room can look back and say, if I could do life again, I would do some things differently. And those kind of regrets either lead us to condemnation or they lead us to a place of forgiveness, to where our regrets are redeemed. And that's Psalm 22. The second question that's answered is found in that middle part of the trilogy, Psalm 23. It addresses the question, what about my present? How is it that I live today? And when tomorrow is today, how will I live today? And then Psalm 24 addresses the ultimate question, what about my future? Little breeze just starting out in life. But there's still the same question about Bree's future that there is about my dad, who's in the shadows of the closing portion of his life. And whether we're a year old or 90 years old, we all have a question. What happens to me after I die? And Psalm 24 addresses that. You see, herein lies all of our worries. For every problem is either behind us or around us or it's looming in front of us. Tension in life comes in three tenses. We worry about the mistakes and the misfortunes of yesterday. We become anxious about today with the trials and tribulations that are in front of us right now. And we often get apprehensive about our future, which can be as uncertain as the wind. So Psalm 22, 23, 24, this is what, I love this title that Rob Morgan gave these three chapters. This is God's triad of truth to deal with life, whatever tense we're in. If we're in the moment where we're thinking about our past, God's got encouragement. If we are living in the pressure-packed moment of today, God's got relief. If we are living in the angst of what might happen in the future, God's got us covered. Psalm 22. If you're already at Psalm 23, you're pretty close to 22. I don't know if you ever write in your Bible, but I don't know when, I didn't date this, but somebody in the past must have preached on this. And I wrote two things at the beginning of chapter 22 in my Bible. The first thing that I wrote is this: God writes history in advance. This is his story. And God is quite capable of writing history in advance. And that's what he does in Psalm 22. For this passage was written 1,000 years before the birth of Christ. 1,000 years. It's one of the most momentous messianic chapters in all of the Old Testament. It is prophetic in nature. 1,000 years before the birth of Christ, 1,000 plus years before the events of Calvary took place, Psalm 22 gives us the very words that Jesus would later speak from the cross. Notice verse 1 of 22. My God, my God. Can you finish it? Why have you forsaken me? And can you quote it because you knew that it was the first verse of Psalm 22? Or can you quote it because of something else? Something else, yeah. Well, when do we quote it from? words of Jesus when he hung on the cross. And yet here it is, 1,000 years before. And it's predicted. Not only are the words of Jesus spoken from the cross recorded here, but conversations of his persecutors are also pre-recorded in the context of these 30-some verses in this chapter. Psalm 22 predicts the traumas that Christ would suffer during his life on earth. It describes his crucifixion. And guys, just a quick pause. Did you know crucifixion wasn't thought of yet? At the time this was written, crucifixion was not practiced. It was not a means of punishment. It was not a means of execution yet. And yet here it is recorded for us. It includes the stripping and the piercing and the thirsting and the exposure and the insults and the humiliation and the death of Jesus Christ. It's as if David the psalmist were standing at the foot of the cross and he's got his paints. And he's got his, what do you call what you paint on? Canvas, thank you very much. Senior moment. It's as if he's an artist and he's got his paints and his canvas and he's painting this picture as it's unfolding before him. It's like he's a journalist at an event and he's recording the events as they happen, and yet it's 1,000 years before. My God, why have you forsaken me? Do you understand how precious those words are? Because Jesus was forsaken, you and I are now forgiven. Because Jesus was beaten, you and I now are healed. Because Jesus was thirsty, you and I can now drink from the rivers of living water. Because Christ died, we now have an eternal home in heaven. No matter how deep our regrets of our past, no matter how searing our conscience may have been or how messy the past was, you and I can start each day because of the finished work of Psalm 22. We can start each day with a clean slate and a fresh beginning. All of our failures have been washed away in the blood of Jesus Christ. Psalm 22 ends with this declaration. The last verse of Psalm 22 says, "They will come and declare his righteousness to a people who will be born, for he has done this." Do you know who that verse is talking about? You, me. I'm declaring what he's done right here to you. That's now about 3,500 years ago this was written. And he's talking about us here today. Finishing the crucifixion scene in Psalm 22, the very next line after the last verse of Psalm 22, the very next thing I read in my Bible is this, Psalm 23. Is that what shows up next in writing after that last word? Very next thing I see is bold print, Psalm 23. Suddenly, we're now in the care not of the crucified Christ, but of the risen Lord. He is now the good shepherd that the New Testament says will lay down his life for his sheep. This good shepherd who longs to care for our present needs. Notice that almost all of the verbs that you will read or quote in Psalm 23 are in the present tense. Psalm 23 is a song for today. He makes me, he leads me, he restores me, he guides me, he is with me, he comforts me, he prepares a table for me, my cup overflows. His shepherding ministries of this risen Savior are for us today. Psalm 23 takes care of today. Here's what I want to do. I want us to read this together, and I'm sure we've got multiple translations here, so I've asked Lynn to throw it up on the screen for us, all right? This is NIV. I memorized King James, so if I happen to mess up, okay? Don't hold it against me. But I want us to read this out loud together. This might be the start of some of you, of your memory work, okay? For the rest of us, it might be our remember work, okay? We're going to remember and reflect. So let's read it together. The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not be in want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside quiet waters. He restores my soul. He guides me in paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Even though I will fear no evil, for you are with me.
Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. You anoint my head with oil. Surely goodness and love will follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Amen. As we continue reading our trilogy of Psalms, our eyes fall on the next line of biblical text. And it says Psalm 24. Notice the opening declaration of Psalm 24. The earth is the Lord's and all of its fullness. We sing that in a song around here from time to time. And as we read the 10 verses of Psalm 24, we're taken to the glorious city of our soon coming King. This passage, it says, "Lift up your heads, O you gates, and be lifted up, you everlasting doors, and the King of glory shall come in." I grew up hearing a song sung in church called "The King is Coming." The King is coming. This psalm sounds like the book of Revelation. Go read Revelation, read Psalm 24. A lot of similarities between the two. Psalm 24 is a description of the joy of the enthronement of Jesus Christ, the King of glory, the one who was crucified, the one who rose again to be our shepherd, and the one who is coming again as our King of glory. It reminds us that God provides everlasting life and eternal joy for His children, that He Himself is the resurrection and the life, and because He lives, you and I can live also. One day soon, we will all see Him in all of His glory. One day soon, He will come for us. Or, if before that time, we will go to be with Him. And guys, you and I need to remember something. As we're walking through the valleys of the shadows, all of our enemies are already defeated. We don't lose. All of our problems are temporary. Jesus said, "In this world, you will have trouble, but," I love the big buts in Scripture. These are good. "But I have overcome the world." And all of our blessings, they last forever. They're eternal. While everything in this world is transient, here today, gone tomorrow, everything about the new heaven and the new earth is transcendent. It rises above. Psalm 24 is the glorious three-part poem that focuses in verse 1 and 2 on the greatness of our Creator. In verses 3 through 6, the privilege that we have of coming into His presence to worship. And in verses 7 through 10, it challenges us and encourages us with the nearing day when the King will come for His kingdom. All of our apprehensions about the future will be lost in celebration, and all of our sorrows about the past will be drowned out by the music accompanying the King of Glory. These three songs are a threefold picture of the ministry that flows from the Messiah's heart into our needs, whether they are past, present, or future. For Jesus is the Alpha, the beginning. He's the Omega. He's the end. And He's everything in between. The Scripture says this Jesus is the same yesterday, today, and forever. The Savior's cross of Psalm 23 takes care of any of our yesterdays. The shepherd's staff or crook of Psalm 23 takes care of today. And the sovereign King's crown will take care of all of our tomorrows. Psalm 22 wants to bring us to the foot of Mount Calvary where Christ was crucified. Psalm 24 centers us at the base of Mount Zion where we see Christ's triumphant return. And between them, where we're living right now, is this lovely valley of Psalm 23 with its gentle pastures, with its sloping meadows, and sometimes its very dramatic canyons and valleys. But our shepherd holds us safely, and He alone can take care of our past and our future. Whether it's in green pastures or oily waters where Maurice found himself, whether we're lying on our backs in a highland meadow or whether we are treading water in the open sea, the Lord is my shepherd. I want to close today with a 6-minute video clip. Some of you may have seen it. It's been making the rounds in the last couple of days on Facebook. Shelley caught it, said, Tim, have you seen this? And I had not. This is a 6-minute clip from a husband's eulogy at his wife's memorial service. Here is a very rare occasion where I believe that a professional athlete is worthy of the power of influence that he possesses. His name is Monty Williams. Monty Williams' spiritual maturity in this video is a testimony of where God would love for all of us to aspire to be in our spiritual maturity. Monty's wife was killed while I was in Africa in a car accident in Oklahoma City. Another driver lost control of her car, crossed the meridian, and hit head-on into her car, and both drivers were killed. Monty Williams is literally walking in the shadow-filled valley as he shares his thoughts. This is not months later after he's had time to recover. This is right in the middle of the valley. He's a former NBA player. He is currently the assistant coach with the Oklahoma Thunder. And this is a man who fully understands what it means for the Lord to be his shepherd. A shepherd who takes care of our past, our present, and our future. Would you dim the lights, please? And let's turn our attention to the screen.
The Bible says in Psalms 133:1, behold how good and pleasant it is when brothers dwell in unity. And I think that's what we've done. And that's what Ingrid would have wanted. Psalm 73:1 says, God is good. And 1 John 4:16 says, God is love. During times like this, it's easy to forget that because what we've gone through is pretty tough and it's hard and we want an answer. And we don't always get that answer when we want it. But we can't lose sight of the fact that God loves us. And that's what my wife, and that's what I try to, however badly, exhibit on a daily basis. But God does love us. He loved me so much that he sent his son to die for my sins. And I, for one, know that I'm not the man that you guys see every day. And only God could cover that. He loved me so much that he gave me a wife that loved every part of me. And she fit me perfectly. And I know different players that I've had over the years probably got tired of me talking about my wife, but I used to always think to myself, like, who else was I going to talk about? So that never bothered me. Romans 8:28 says, and we know that God causes all things to work together for good to those who love God, to those who are called according to his purpose. All of this will work out. As hard as this is for me and my family and for you, this will work out. I know this because I've seen this in my life. See, back in 1990, at the University of Notre Dame, I had a doctor look me in the face and say, you're gonna die if you keep playing basketball. And I had testing done, test after test, shipping me all over the place to try to figure out a way for me to play. And it didn't work out. And I kept that from Ingrid. She knew I was having some tests done, but she didn't know the severity of the situation. So my career was over at the age of 18. And we had a press conference, and I left the press conference by myself, and I went to her dorm room, and I told her what happened. And the very next words out of her mouth after we probably cried a little bit, she said, honey, Jesus can heal your heart. And I'm evidence that God can work it out. I don't care what you're going through. This is hard for my family, but this will work out. And my wife would punch me if I were to sit up here and whine about what's going on. That doesn't take away the pain. But it will work out. Because God causes all things to work out. You just can't quit. You can't give in. See, the Bible says Satan comes to steal, kill, and destroy. And America teaches us to just numb that, and it's not true, but it is true. All you got to do is look around you. Get outside of these walls, and you know it's true. This will work out. Doesn't mean it's not hard. Doesn't mean it's not painful. Doesn't mean we don't have tough times, and we're going to have tough times. What we need is the Lord. And that's what my wife tried to exhibit every single day. Now, I'm going to close with this, and I think it's the most important thing that we need to understand. Everybody's praying for me and my family, which is right. But let us not forget that there were two people in this situation. And that family needs prayer as well. And we have no ill will towards that family. In my house, we have a sign that says, "As for me and my house, we will serve the Lord." We cannot serve the Lord if we don't have a heart of forgiveness. That family didn't wake up wanting to hurt my wife. Life is hard. It is very hard. And that was tough. But we hold no ill will towards the Donaldson family. And we, as a group, brothers united in unity, should be praying for that family because they grieve as well. So let's not lose sight of what's important. God will work this out. My wife is in heaven. God loves us. God is love. And when we walk away from this place today, let's celebrate, because my wife is where we all need to be. And I'm envious of that. But I got 5 crumb snatchers I got to deal with. I love you guys for taking time out of your day to celebrate my wife. We didn't lose her. When you lose something, you can't find it. I know exactly where my wife is. I'll miss holding her hand. I'll miss talking with my wife. Sam and Coach Donovan probably couldn't figure out why I always wanted to get out of the office, me and Mo Cheeks. Mo probably wanted to go do something else, but we always wanted to get out of the office. I just enjoy being with my wife. I enjoy being with my family. And most of the times we didn't do anything. We'd just be at the house sitting around doing nothing. I'm going to miss that. Let's not lose sight of what's important. God is important. What Christ did on the cross is important. Let's not lose sight of that family that also lost someone that they love. I love you guys. I hope I get a chance to hug and shake a hand and give a kiss on the cheek. But let's keep what's important at the forefront. Thank you.
Monty gets it. He's got it. He's got the triad trilogy. Jesus Christ, who died for us. In the needs of his loss and the loss of the other family, God can meet those needs, and his wife is in heaven. That's the future. He gets it. That is what Psalm 23 wants to make out of each of us. Men and women that in the midst of the valley, we know that God is good and that God is love, and that God will cause all things to work out. When it doesn't look like they're working out, Maurice, in an oily water of a sea, Monty, in the midst of raising his kids and the loss of his wife, "The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want." I don't know where you are in this journey, but the words of Ingram should speak to all of us. Jesus can heal our heart from our past regrets to our present troubles to our future uncertainties. Jesus can heal our hearts. Let's pray. Father, if there's someone who is here this morning whose spiritual heart is in need of healing, who needs relief from regret, who needs peace in the midst of trouble, who desires hope for tomorrow. May they put their trust in a Christ who was crucified yet lives, and a shepherd who lives and cares for us, and in a king who has our future all worked out. Thank you for hearing our prayers today. Thank you for the examples of Maurice and Monty that we can use to encourage us along our spiritual growth and maturity. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Have a good afternoon. If you're 25 to 40, don't break my heart.